In the era where humongous amount of data gets generated on a day-to-day basis, data plays a crucial role in decision-making for business processes. So, to handle data, we need databases and database management systems, and one such popular database management system is the Microsoft SQL Server. So, hi all, this is Sahithi on behalf of Edureka, and I welcome you to this session on SQL Server interview questions. So, in this session, guys, we'll understand the top questions related to SQL Server that could be asked in your interviews. So without any further delay, let's get started. But before that, I would like to request all of you to subscribe to our Edureka YouTube channel to get daily notified on the top trending technologies. On that note, let's look at the first question for today's session, that is, mention the differences between SQL Server and MySQL. Now, this is one of the most popular questions asked, as you know, both of them are relational database management systems. So if you have to give the differences between SQL Server and MySQL, then I would say SQL Server is developed by Microsoft and MySQL was developed by Oracle. SQL Server is a licensed product, so you do not have the free edition for it. And MySQL is an open source software, right? So if you want to know how to install both of them, I'll leave the links in the description box below. But let me tell you over here that, you know, you can easily install MySQL in very few steps. But when it comes to SQL Server, you have to enable few ports and name pipes, and then you have to follow a proper step to configure the databases. So I would say if you have to compare the installation step between both of them, then I would say installing MySQL is very easy comparative to that of SQL Server. Coming to the next difference, SQL Server supports C#, Java, C++, PHP, Visual Basic, Perl, Python, and Ruby. Coming to MySQL, MySQL also supports various programming languages like, you know, PHP, Perl, Python, Ruby, and so on, right? So both of them offer quite good amount of support to build various kinds of applications using different technologies. Coming to the next difference, I would say SQL Server doesn't allow any kind of database file manipulation while running the database, whereas MySQL allows database file manipulations while running. SQL Server allows query cancellation midway in the process, but this is not the scenario in MySQL, as MySQL does not allow query cancellation midway in the process. Moving on to the next difference, while backing up the data, SQL Server doesn't block the database, but when it comes to MySQL, it blocks the database, right? And coming to the next difference, you can say that, you know, SQL Server takes a large amount of operation storage space, whereas that's not the scenario in MySQL, as it takes a less amount of operation storage space. Coming to the last difference, that, you know, SQL Server is available in the Express and the Custom mode, and MySQL is available in the MySQL Community Edition and the Enterprise Edition. So guys, these are a few differences between SQL Server and MySQL. Apart from that also, you can answer the interviewer by talking about your personal experience while using SQL Server and MySQL, right? You might have created databases in both of them, and maybe you have manipulated data using both of them, right? So you can talk, you know, what happens when you want to do a specific set of actions in MySQL and SQL Server. So with this, we come to an end to the first question. Now let's move forward with the second question, that is, what do you understand by SQL Server agent? Now, SQL Server agent is one of the most popular component of SQL Server, right? So basically, if you have to explain SQL Server, then you can just say that, you know, SQL Server agent is a Windows service which is used to schedule and execute the jobs. So here, each job contains one or more steps, and each step can contain a task. So what happens is that the SQL Server agent uses the SQL Server to store the job information and run a job on a schedule. Now, the main components of SQL Server agent are basically jobs, schedules, operators, and alerts. So if you have to explain with an example over here, you can just consider the example like, you know, if an enterprise wishes to take the backup of the company servers at 9 p.m. on every Friday. Now, what you can do is you can just automate this task and let the task happen at the scheduled time. But in a scenario where a backup encounters an error, the SQL Server agent records the events and notifies the corresponding team. So that's how you can use the SQL Server agent, guys. Well, this was one of the simple usage. You can do it in a very complicated way also. So I would just say that, you know, SQL Server agent is one of the most important concept, or you can say the most important component that you need to understand about Microsoft SQL Server. So moving on in this tutorial on Microsoft SQL Server, let's look at the next question, that is, mention the different authentication modes in SQL Server. Now, before I tell you the different authentication modes in SQL Server, let me tell you that the authentication mode is used for authenticating a user in the SQL Server. So the authentication mode is selected while setting up the database engine, and the different authentication modes offered by SQL Server are basically the Windows authentication mode and the mixed mode. Now, the Windows authentication mode is used to connect the server through a Windows account. So what basically happens over here is that, you know, the server takes the computer's username and password for authentication purposes. And also the SQL Server authentication mode is disabled in this mode. Coming to mixed mode, the mixed mode is used to connect with an instance of SQL Server using either the SQL Server authentication or the Windows authentication. So in this mode, basically there's a username and a password set by the user for the database. And then when you want to log into your SQL Server, you have to mention those username and passwords. So guys, these were two authentication modes, that is the Windows mode and the mixed mode. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is mention the differences between local and global temporary tables. Now the local tables are basically those tables which only exist for the duration of the connection or the duration of that particular statement which is executing. But when it comes to global temporary tables, the global temporary tables exist permanently in the databases and only the rows get deleted when the connection gets closed. Right? So over here you have to remember that, you know, the structure does not get deleted, only the rows get deleted. So if you have to talk about the syntax between both of them, then I would say the local temporary variable, you can write a syntax as, you know, create table and then put a hash mark and mention the table name. Coming to global temporary tables, the only difference in syntax is that, you know, you have to mention two hashes. So you'll mention create table hash and then again a hash and then you'll mention the table name. So guys, these were the differences between local temporary table and global temporary table. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is how can you check the version of SQL Server? Now I would say you could be asked this question just to check whether you have a good hand on the commands or not. So to check the version of SQL Server, you just have to mention the command that you can see on my screen, that is select and then @version. Now this particular command will basically give you the version of the SQL Server that's installed onto your system. And this gives an output as one nvarchar string. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what is single user mode and what are the steps you should follow to start SQL Server in a single user mode? Now as the name suggests, the single user mode, this particular mode is basically used when you only want a single user to be active on your SQL Server. So single user mode is a mode where only single user connects to the server. Now you might be wondering, when do we use it, right? Now let me tell you that, you know, it may often happen that you would want to start an instance of a SQL Server in the single user mode. And you would want to do this either when you want to recover the data from other database system, or maybe you want to change the server configurations. So basically there are two scenarios where you would want to use the single user mode. That is either you want to recover data from the other database system, or you would want to change the server configurations. So when you start the SQL Server in single user mode, then any member of the computer's local administrators group gets connected to the instance of SQL Server as the system admin. Now, once you start the SQL Server in a single user mode, what happens is that, you know, a single user connects to the server and the checkpoint process is not executed since it is executed by default at the startup. Also, note that, you know, you have to stop the SQL Server agent service before connecting to an instance of the SQL Server in the single user mode. Now, this is a little bit of an extra information that you can give to an interviewer, but I would say it would be nice if you answer like that. Now to start the SQL Server in single user mode, you basically have to use the command of SQL command hyphen M, right? So you just type in SQL CMD hyphen M, and then you can start the SQL Server in the single user mode. Now to connect through a query editor in the management studio use, you can just mention hyphen M, and then you can mention the Microsoft SQL Server management studio query. That query is completely on your basis that how you want to connect, but these are the two ways through which you can start the SQL Server in a single user mode. So guys, that was about this question. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what is the SQL Server Profiler? The Microsoft SQL Server Profiler is an interface used to create and manage traces. So basically what it does is that, you know, it analyzes and replaces the trace results. So here the events are saved in a trace file which are later analyzed or are used to replay a specific series of steps while debugging an issue. Now you can use the SQL Server Profiler for activities as you can see on my screen, like, you know, finding the root cause of the problem, monitoring the performance of SQL Server to handle workloads, diagnosing the slow queries, capturing a series of SQL statements causing a problem to further replicate the problem on the test server while debugging the issue, and also correlate the performance counters to debug the issues easily. So guys, this was about SQL Server Profiler. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what is a TCP/IP port on which SQL Server runs? Now this is one of the most interesting questions that is asked in interviews, that is because, you know, it's a number that you have to guess exactly and then your answer cannot be wrong, right? So well, the answer to this particular question is that, you know, the TCP/IP port on which SQL Server runs is 1433, right? So that's 1433 that you have to keep in your minds. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are subqueries in SQL Server, and then can you mention few properties of it? So if I have to explain you what a subquery is, a subquery is a query inside another query where a query is defined to retrieve data or information back from the database. So in a subquery, the outer query is called the main query, whereas the inner query is called the subquery. Subqueries are always executed first, and the result of the subquery is passed to the main query. Now, subqueries can be nested inside a select statement, update statement, or any other query. A subquery can also use comparison operators like, you know, greater than, less than, or equal to. Now, if you have to mention few properties of subqueries, then you can say that, you know, it must be enclosed in parentheses, as it must be executed first before the main query. More than one query can be included, and a subquery should not have the order by clause, but can definitely include the where, group by, and the having clauses. The subquery must be on the right-hand side of the comparison operator of the main query and must include a select clause and a from clause. So guys, these are a few properties of subqueries. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, how do you start single user mode in clustered installations? Now in clustered installations, the SQL Server basically uses the DLL available connections and thus blocks any other connection to the server. Now in this state, if you try to bring the SQL Server agent resources online, then it may fail the SQL resources to a different node as it could be configured to a group. So to start a single user mode in cluster installations, you have to follow the steps that you can see on my screen. You have to first go to the advanced properties and then remove the -m startup parameter. After that, you have to put the SQL Server resource offline and then issue the command from the command prompt and make sure that, you know, you're at the current owner node of the group. So the command is basically net start msql server /m. After that, you have to verify from the cluster administrator or failover cluster management console that a SQL Server resource is still offline or not. And then you have to connect the SQL Server by using the command sqlcmd -e -s and then do the required operations. Once an operation is complete, you have to close the command prompt and then bring back the SQL Server and other resources online through cluster administrator. So guys, these are few steps that you have to follow to start single user mode in cluster installations. Now moving on to the next question, that is, what do you understand by replication in SQL Server, and what are the different types of replication that are present in SQL Server? Now replication in Microsoft SQL Server is a process to synchronize the data across multiple servers. Now this is generally done by the replica set, and these sets provide multiple copies of data with redundancy and high availability on different servers. Not only this, but replication also provides a mechanism to recover from the failures. So it basically removes the dependencies from single server to protect the loss of data from that particular server. Now the different types of replication available in SQL Server are merge replication, transactional replication, and snapshot replication. Now the merged replication basically groups the data from various sources to a single centralized database and is used in the server to the client information. Coming to transactional replication, this particular replication is basically a process of distributing data from publisher to subscriber and is used in the server to server environments. Moving on to the final replication, that is a snapshot replication. The snapshot replication basically distributes data exactly as it appears at a specific moment and is used for replicating data which changes infrequently. So guys, that was about replication and its type. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are the differences between Microsoft SQL Server and Oracle? Now if you have to mention the differences between Microsoft SQL Server and Oracle, then MS SQL Server basically provides simple and easy syntax, whereas Oracle consists of complex and comparatively more efficient syntaxes. The MS SQL Server uses basically the Transact SQL or the T-SQL, whereas Oracle uses the PL SQL. Moving on to the next difference, that is, you know, SQL Server does not support query optimization, but Oracle supports query optimization and uses the star query optimization. Moving on to the next difference, in SQL Server, rollbacks are not allowed in the transaction processes, but in Oracle, rollbacks are definitely allowed during the transaction processes. SQL Server allows incremental, partial, and full backups, whereas Oracle allows incremental, full, file level, and differential backups. SQL Server does not support clustering, whereas Oracle offers support for clustered configurations. In SQL Server, statements such as insert, update, delete are executed serially, whereas in Oracle, statements such as insert, update, delete, and merge are executed parallelly. And finally, coming to the last difference, jobs are scheduled via the SQL Server agent in SQL Server, whereas jobs are scheduled via the Oracle scheduler or the OEM in Oracle. So guys, these were a few differences between SQL Server and Oracle. So as I said before, you can also talk about your personal experience while using both of them. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by intent logs? Now Microsoft SQL Server uses a log hierarchy whenever the data is read or something is changed in the data. So whenever a row is read, the SQL Server acquires a shared log, and whenever you change a row, the SQL Server acquires an exclusive log. So these logs are basically incompatible with each other, and this is where the intent logs come into the picture. So the intent logs are basically used to indicate at a higher level which logs are applied within a log hierarchy. Now there are mainly three kinds of intent logs, that is the intent shared log, the intent update log, and the intent exclusive log. Now as the name suggests, the intent shared log is basically used when you have a shared log at the row level. Coming to intent update log, the intent update log is used when you have an update log at the row level. And finally, coming to intent exclusive log, this particular log is used when you have an exclusive log at the row level. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are the steps you must follow to hide SQL Server instances? Now the steps that you must follow to hide SQL Server instances are as you can see on my screen. Initially, you have to open the SQL Server Configuration Manager, and then you have to go to the SQL Server Network Configuration. After that, in the SQL Server Network Configuration, go to Protocols and choose the instance of the SQL Server. Later on, you just have to right click on the instance and select the properties. After that, you'll see a dialog box which opens up. So go to the Flags tab in that particular dialog box, and then you see an option of Hide Instance over there. So over there, you just have to go to that particular option of Hide Instance and just say yes, and then open the drop down and choose yes. So once you choose yes, you just have to finally click on OK, and then automatically your instance will be hidden. So guys, these were the steps to hide the instance in SQL Server. Next in this tutorial on SQL Server, let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by data quality services in SQL Server? So the data quality services in SQL Server is basically a knowledge driven data quality product, right? So the SQL Server data quality services enable the user to build a knowledge base and thereafter use it to perform tasks such as correction, deduplication, enrichment, and standardization of data. Apart from this, the data quality services also provide profiling and enable you to perform data cleaning with the help of cloud-based data services. Now the DQS services or the data quality services basically consists of two components, that is the data quality server and the data quality client. Now talking about the server first, so the data quality server is basically a SQL Server instance feature consisting of three SQL Server catalogs with data quality functionality and storage. Coming to data quality client, it is also a SQL Server feature which users can use to perform computer-assisted data quality analysis and manage the data quality interactively, right? So guys, that was about the data quality services. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, explain magic tables in SQL Server. Now magic tables are tables which are automatically created in SQL Server and are used to internally store the inserted updated values for DML operations such as select, delete, insert, update, and so on, right? So basically guys, magic tables are just automatically created tables in SQL Server used to basically store values, you know, maybe inserted, updated, or deleted. And you can understand that, you know, magic tables are used on a temporary basis. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by change data capture? So change data capture, or most commonly known as CDC, is used to record insert, update, delete activities applied on the tables. So as the name suggests, the change data capture is used to capture the data that has been changed recently. So the column information and the metadata required to apply the changes to the target information are captured for the modified rows and are eventually stored in the change tables. So these change tables are the mirror images of the original column structure. So guys, that was about change data structure. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by triggers, and mention the different types of it? So if you have to explain triggers, then triggers are used to execute batches of SQL code whenever insert, delete, or update commands are executed against the table. So basically, triggers are automatically executed whenever the data is modified based on the data manipulation operations, or you can just understand that, you know, triggers are triggered when there's an event happening. So the different types of triggers are basically insert, update, delete, and instead of. So guys, that was about triggers. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by recursive stored procedures? So recursive stored procedure is basically a problem solving method through which you can arrive at the solution again and again and again, right? So in programming also we see recursive functions, right? So you can just keep calling back the function, and with the help of that you can keep getting solution again and again and again, right? So that's the same in SQL also. Recursive stored procedures is basically a method through which you can arrive at the solution again and again. So that was about recursive stored procedures, guys. Let's move forward with the next question, that is explain log shipping and its advantages. Now, log shipping is basically the process of automation of backup to restore databases from one standalone server to another standalone standby server. So you can understand log shipping as one of those disaster recovery solutions, as it makes sure that, you know, even if one server fails, the standby server will have the same data as that of the server itself. So the advantages of log shipping are, as you can see in my screen, it needs low maintenance and is easy to set up. The secondary database created is used for read-only purposes only. And you can also create multiple secondary standby servers. Not only this, but it also allows a delay specified by the user for the time between the primary servers backup the log of the primary database and when the secondary servers restore or apply the log backup. So guys, these were a few advantages of log shipping. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what are trace flags, and mention a few common trace flags that you might have faced. So the trace flags are basically those flags which are used to alter server behaviors or set server characteristics. Now, few common trace flags that all of us use or encounter are basically 1204, 1205, 1222. So all the three of them are used for deadlock information. The 174 trace flag is used to increase the SQL Server Database Engine plan cache bucket count from 40,009 to 1,60,001 on 64-bit systems. Coming to 1118. So 1118 forces uniform extent allocations instead of mixed page allocations. Moving on to the next one, that is 652. Now, 652 is basically used to disable the page prefetching scans, and 2566 is used to basically run the dbcc check db command without the data purity check unless the data purity option is specified. So guys, these are few trace flags that I've encountered or I've used. Now, this answer is not something that, you know, you have to give only these trace flags. There are hundreds of trace flags present. So whatever you have encountered or maybe whatever you have used, you can mention that, right? Now let's move forward with the next one, that is mention the differences between substring and character index in SQL Server. Substring is basically used to return a specific portion of the string in a given string, but whereas the character index is used to return a character position in a given specified string, right? So for example, if you have substring Edureka 1,4. So what the syntax mentions is that, you know, Edureka is our string. 1 is our starting value from where the characters have to be extracted, and 4 is the range till where the characters have to be extracted. So if you count Edureka on your fingers, we have 7 letters, right? So we've mentioned 1 to 4, so our output should be EDUR, right? So it starts with E, that's our first letter, then D, second one, U, third one, and R, fourth one. But when it comes to character index, as I mentioned before, is used to return a character position in the given string, right? So for example, if you mention an example, character index R, Edureka, 1, R is basically the character for which we want to find out the position. Edureka is a string and 1 is the starting range of the string. So if you again count Edureka on your fingers, then you see R is at the fourth position. So we see output as 4. So guys, these were the differences between substring and character index in SQL Server. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what do you understand by analysis services in SQL Server? So analysis services in Microsoft SQL Server is an analytical data engine used in business analytics and decision support. So the service basically provides enterprise-grade semantic models for client applications and reports such as Power BI, Microsoft Excel, and other visualization tools. So the analysis services is basically available in platforms like, you know, Azure Analysis Services, Power BI Premium, and SQL Server Analysis Services. So guys, that was about analysis services in SQL Server. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what do you understand by mirroring, and mention few advantages of it. So mirroring in SQL Server is basically designed to maintain a hot standby server that is consistent with the primary server in terms of the transaction. Also, the transaction log records are sent from the principal server to the secondary server. Now, the advantages of mirroring are, as you can see on my screen, it consists of an automatic failover mechanism. It is more efficient than the log shipping and is more robust, and the primary server is synced with the secondary server in real time. So guys, that was about mirroring. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is when do you think a developer should use SQL Server based cursors? So SQL Server based cursors are used when you wish to work on a record at an instance of time rather than taking all the data from a table as a bulk. However, cursors are not preferred to be used when large volumes of data is present, as it affects the performance. So in a scenario where it is not possible to avoid the cursors, then I would suggest try to reduce the number of records to process by using a temporary table and then eventually build the cursor from this. So I think, guys, this is one of the most practical questions that could be asked, where the interviewer checks whether you have practical knowledge of where SQL can be used and how you can use different commands or different functionalities based on the scenarios. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what part of database design do you think affects the performance of a SQL Server based application? Well, I would say the physical and the logical design plays an important role in the performance of SQL Server based applications. And we need to ensure that the correct data is captured in the proper tables, the data items have proper relationships between them, and the data redundancy is reduced. I would also suggest that, you know, while you're designing a database, make sure that it is an iterative process to achieve all the required system goals and is under constant observation to make sure, you know, all the client requirements are added and the database satisfies the requirement. Now I'm saying this because, you know, once the database design is set, it's very tough to change the database design according to the requirements that come later on. So you cannot change the basic entities of the databases, but you can only add new relationships and data items. So I would say if something affects the performance of a SQL Server based application, then I would say the physical and the logical design of the database affects the most. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, what do you understand by user defined functions in SQL Server? And then what are the steps to create and execute the user defined function in a SQL Server? Well, a user-defined function, as the name suggests, is a function written as per the needs of the user by implementing a specific logic. Now, in these kinds of functions, the user is not limited to any predefined functions and simplifies the complex code of a predefined function by writing a simple code. Apart from this, let me also tell you that, you know, the user-defined function returns a scalar value or a table. Now, to create a user-defined function, you can refer to the example that you can see on my screen. I've just created a function sample func, and then in the brackets I've put either it num int. So basically it's an integer, and then it returns a table as return select star from customers where customer ID equal to either it num, right? We're trying to basically return all the customer IDs from our customer table and store it in a table. Now after that, to execute the function that we had just created, you just have to mention the command select star from sample func, that is basically the function's name. And in brackets, you'll mention the customer ID. So for example, I'd mentioned 10 over here. So that's how, guys, you can create a user-defined function and also execute it. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, how can you ensure that the database and SQL Server-based applications perform well? Well, I would say to ensure that the database and the SQL Server-based applications perform well, a developer must check the types of information stored, the volumes of data, and what data will be accessed. So in a scenario where you're upgrading an existing system, you should analyze the present data, the existing data volumes occur, and then check the method through which the data is accessed to help you understand the problem areas for the design. But on the other hand, if you're creating a new system, then you have to keep the information about what data will be captured, what are the constituents of data, and the relationship between the data items. So like that, the developer can make sure that, you know, the database and SQL Server-based applications can perform well. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, what are relationships in databases and what are the different types of it? Well, I would say a relationship in database management system is a scenario where two entities are related to each other. So basically, if you have two tables, table A and table B, then the table consisting of the foreign key references to that of the primary key of the other table. So the different types of relationships in DBMS or database management systems are one-to-one relationship, one-to-many relationship, many-to-many relationship, and self-referencing relationship. Coming to one-to-one relationship, so this is basically used when a single row in table A is related to single row in table B. Coming to one-to-many relationship, this is used when a single row in table A is related to many rows in table B. Coming to many-to-many relationship, this is used when you have many rows in table A related to many rows in table B. And finally, coming to self-referencing relationship, this is used when a record in table A is related to the same table itself. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are joins in SQL and what are the different types of joins? A join clause is basically used to combine rows from two or more tables based on a related column between them, and it is used to merge two tables or retrieve data from there. So there are mainly four types of joins in SQL: the inner join, the right join, the left join, and the full join. Right, so I'm not going to go into depth of them. So if you want to know how to use SQL joins, you can refer to my session on SQL joins. On that note, let's move forward with the session and let's look into the next question. That is, what is the command dbcc checkdb used for? So the command dbcc checkdb is used to basically check the physical and the logical integrity of all the objects in the mentioned database. So to do that, it basically performs the operations that you can see on my screen. It runs the dbcc check alloc on the mentioned database, and on every table and view in the database, the dbcc check table command is executed. It also runs the dbcc check catalog on the database, and then It validates the contents of every index view in the mentioned database. After that, it also validates the link level consistency between file system directories and table metadata while storing var binary max data in the file system using FileStream. Finally, it validates the service broker data in the database. So if you observe clearly, you just have to execute the dbcc check db command and automatically the dbcc check alloc, the check table and the check catalog command gets executed. Also, note that dbcc is supported on databases that contain memory optimized tables but does not provide repair operations. So basically this implies that you must regularly backup databases and test those backups. So guys, that was about the dbcc check db command. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by check constraint in SQL Server? So the check constraint in SQL Server is basically used to limit the values or the type of data stored in a column. Now once you apply the check constraint on a single column, you can go forward and apply specific values for that particular column. See the example on my screen. I've created a table customers with few columns like customer ID, first name, age and city. And then I've applied the check constraint and then I've given the name to be check underscore customer. And the condition that I've applied is basically age should be greater than 20 and city should be Hyderabad. So guys, that is basically how you can use the check constraint. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what do you understand by coalesce in SQL Server? Now the coalesce function is used to basically return the first non-null expression within the arguments. So the coalesce command is basically used to return a non-null value from more than a single column in arguments. So to use the coalesce command, you can refer to the example that you can see on my screen, that is select coalesce, and then I've mentioned customer ID, customer name, amount from customers, right? So basically customers was our table. And customer ID, customer name, amount are basically our column names, right? So I'm basically trying to return the first non-null expressions from customer ID, customer name, and amount. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, explain the usage of floor function in SQL Server. Now the floor function is used to round up a non-integer value to the previous least integer value. This function returns a unique value after rounding of the digits. Now the syntax is, as you can see on my screen, it's basically floor and then you mention the expression. And if you also want to know how to use it, you can see the example on my screen. I've just mentioned floor and then I've mentioned in brackets 7.3. So it will basically round up the value to 7. So guys, that was about the floor function. Now let's move forward with the next question. That is, what is the command used to check logs in Microsoft SQL Server? So to check logs in a database, you have to use an inbuilt stored procedure, that is SP underscore log. So the syntax is, again, as you can see on my screen, it's SP log. And then you mention @SPID equal to 1 and session ID 1. You can go forward and mention the session ID 2 and so on, right? You can also go forward and explain the command to the interviewer by giving them an example, right? So for example, if you want to list all the logs currently held in an instance of a database engine, you can use the command SP underscore log, as you can see on my screen. I've mentioned use sample database, that is basically my database name. And then I've mentioned go execute SP underscore log and then go again over there. So that is basically how I want to list all the logs currently held in an instance of the database engine. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, mention the three ways to get a count on the number of records in a table. Now the three ways through which you can get a count of the number of records in a table are, as you can see on my screen, you can initially write a query like, you know, select star from table name. This will basically retrieve all the data from the table, right? So, and over there you can clearly get a count of the number of records in the table. The second way is basically you use the count function, right? So for that, you'll write a query like, as you can see on my screen, that is select count and in brackets, you'll mention star from table name, right? So you'll basically count all the row values and then you'll mention. And the third one is basically select rows from indexes where ID equal to object underscore ID, you mention the table name and index ID is less than 2, right? So guys, these are the three ways through which you can get a count of the number of records in a table. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what is the usage of the sign function? Now the sign function is basically used to determine whether the mentioned number is 0, positive or negative. So it will either return 0, plus 1 or minus 1. So the syntax is, as you can see on my screen, it's just sign and in brackets you mention the number. And if you want to see the example is again on my screen, like, you know, if you mention sign 0, then it will return 0. If you mention sign, let's say 21, then it will return 1, and if you mention sign, let's say minus 21, it will return minus 1. So guys, that was about the sign function. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, write a SQL query to find the first weekday of the month. Now to find the first weekday of the month, you can write a query like, as you can see on my screen, that is select date name, and in brackets you'll mention dw, date add, in the brackets again you'll mention dd, date part, and then in brackets again we'll mention DD comma get date, that is basically used to get the current date, plus 1 comma get date as first day, right? So that's how you basically get the weekday of the month. Now date add, date part, get date are all predefined functions that you can use. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is mention the command used to rename the database. Now the command used to rename the database is sp_rename_db. So to know how to use this command, you can look at my screen. You basically have to mention sp_rename_db, and then you have to mention the old database name and then the new database name. So for example, if you have customers initially and then you want to change it to customers information, you mention sp_rename_db customers and then customer information. So that's how guys you can rename the database. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is write a query to find the fifth highest amount paid from the customers table. Now to find the fifth highest amount paid from the customers table, you can write a query as you can see on my screen, that is select top one amount from, and then in a brackets you'll mention select distinct top five amount from customers order by amount in a descending order, and then close the inner brackets and then come out of the brackets and mention order by amount. So basically in a query, we're basically trying to find out the top five distinct amounts paid by the customers in the customer table, and then we'll order it by descending order. And when the output comes to the main query or the outer query, in the outer query, it is ordered by the amount and then it is in a descending order already. So you just pick up the first amount. So guys, that's how you can write a query to find the fifth highest amount paid from the customers table. Now let's move forward with the next question and understand how can we delete a table in SQL Server. Well, to delete a table in SQL Server, you basically have to use the delete command. So the syntax is as you can see on my screen, you just mentioned delete and the table name. So for example, if you have to delete the customers table, then you mention delete customers. So guys, that was about how you can delete a table in SQL Server. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what is the purpose of update statistics and scope identity function. The update statistics function is basically used to update the information used by the indexes, such as the distribution of key values for one or more statistics groups is mentioned in the index view or the table. Coming to scope identity function, the scope identity function is used to create identity values for tables in the current execution scope. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what do you understand by physical only option in DBCC checkDB command? Well, the physical only option is used to limit the checking to the integrity or physical structure of the record headers, page, and also the allocation consistency of the database. The physical only check is used to provide a small overhead check of the physical consistency of the database. And this option also causes a shorter runtime for DBCC checkDB on large databases. So it's generally recommended for frequent use on production systems. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is can you explain how long are the logs retained with repeatable read and serializable isolation levels during a read operation with low level locking? Well, with repeatable read and serializable isolation levels, the logs are held during the transaction. Answer to this particular question is that, you know, the logs are held during the transaction, but if you consider the read committed, then the logs are held for the isolation level. So guys, that was about this question. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is mention the differences between having and where clause. Well, the having clause is basically used only with the select statement, whereas the where clause is used in a group by clause. The having clause is used with a group by function in a query, whereas the where clause is applied to each row before they're a part of the group by function in a query. Also, note that, you know, whenever group by function is not used, having behaves like a where clause, right? So guys, these were the differences between having and where clauses. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what do you understand by integration services in SQL Server? Well, integration services is a platform offered by Microsoft to build enterprise level data transformation solutions and integration. Now these services solve complex business problems by loading data warehouses, perform data wrangling, copy or download files, and manage SQL Server objects. Also, integration services can extract and transform data from a wide variety of sources such as relational data sources, XML data files, load the data into more than a single database. So basically, you can use the integration services to create solutions without coding or maybe code complex tasks, program the extensive integration object model to create objects. Not only this, but the integration services include a good set of built-in tasks and transformations and graphical tools used for building packages, and also contain the catalog database to store, run, and manage packages. So guys, that was about integration services in SQL Server. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is what do you understand by hotfixes and patches in SQL Server? So hotfixes are single cumulative software packages applied to live systems. So basically, this includes one or more files used to address a problem in a software product. The patches are a program installed on the machines to rectify the problem occurred in the system and ensure the security of that particular system. So basically, hotfixes are a kind of patch offered by Microsoft SQL Server to address specific issues. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, can you name a few encryption mechanisms in SQL Server? Well, few encryption mechanisms in SQL Server to encrypt the data in database are, as you can see on my screen, that is transparent data encryption, symmetric keys, asymmetric keys, transact SQL functions, and certificates. Right? So these are few encryption mechanisms through which you can protect your data or you can encrypt the data in a database. Now let's move forward with the next question, that is, what are the options which must be sent to allow the usage of optimistic models? Well, the options that must be set to allow the usage of optimistic models are the read underscore committed underscore snapshot option and allow underscore snapshot underscore isolation option, right? So basically these two options are used, that is the read committed snapshot and the allow snapshot isolation option. So the read committed snapshot option is basically used to read the committed optimistic model, and the allow snapshot isolation is used for the snapshot isolation levels, right? So guys, these are the two options that you must keep in mind. Now let's move forward with the final question for this particular session, that is, what are the common performance issues in SQL Server? Now this is one of the most practical questions I would say that could be asked, because you know it's completely on your experience basis on how much you have used the databases and how many issues that you have faced. So the most common performance issues in SQL Server are fragmentation, input-output bottlenecks, blocking queues, deadlocks, and unused indexes. So these are a few common performance issues that I had seen. But if you think you've also seen any other issues, you can definitely go forward and mention it. So I would say in this particular question also, please explain with examples on which scenarios did you see the performance issues and how did you resolve it. So on that note, guys, we come to an end to this particular session. I hope you found this session interesting and informative. So this was a set of questions that I thought were important for interviews. So if you have faced any interviews for database administrators and then you have few questions on your mind, please comment them in the comment section below. Until then, that's all from our side today. I hope you liked the session. So thank you and have a great day.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to Edureka channel to learn more. Happy learning!